Good morning. Welcome back to Dr. Dan's Meaningful Monday Morning Update. As always, thank you for giving me this opportunity to share a little bit of mental health and meaning for you in your day. Today's topic is another one that I've probably shared many different times in many different ways. I never quite envisioned myself becoming a marriage and family therapist. That was never one of my specialties. But when you work with suffering people, struggling people, you find out very often their struggles exist in relationship, or maybe the relationship may be the cause of some of their struggles. And so today I just wanted to throw out a couple ideas for you if you are in a intimate and connected relationship. Some ideas to keep that relationship healthy, or if it's struggling, to maybe move it back into a healthier situation. So this is just a couple of notes I jotted down over the past few weeks about some of the more common, I guess, topics that I share in couples therapy. Some of the basics of good relationships, the idea of validation and not fixing. Now, I've given this little lecture to many men specifically. And I usually start by qualifying, look, first of all, as men, we're not often good with validation. We kind of stereotypically want to fix things. I had to go to school for many years to learn to undo that, to understand the power of validation. And let me tell you, I'm still not always great within my own relationship. But when somebody comes to you, when your partner, spouse, or somebody close to you comes to you with a problem, they don't often want you to fix it. I would venture to guess more times than not, they don't want you to fix it. And the fact that you think you can fix it and they can't comes off maybe a little demeaning, or at least frustrating. That can be damaging to a relationship, thinking you have to fix the other person's problems, or you have to fix the other person. Sometimes, many times, most of the time, all that person needs is for you to look at them and say, wow, that must have felt blank. Insert emotion here. Choose an emotion. Try to identify that emotion. In doing so, you give yourself the opportunity to connect and understand and maybe even get it wrong. And that's okay, because ideally, when you're communicating in a healthy way, that other person will share with you and say, no, it didn't feel that way. It felt this way. But thanks for trying to understand. Don't go about trying to fix your partner's problems unless they ask you for it. That is one key to a healthy relationship. Now, if you've known me for a while, you know I'm a big fan of the Myers-Briggs type indicator. I am a certified Myers-Briggs practitioner. If you want to learn more about it, you know where to find me. But one of the easy opportunities in identifying some Myers-Briggs types and profiles in your relationship, know the difference between introverts and extroverts. And just really quick, the common one, extroverts are those people that have many acquaintances or surface level relationships, whereas an introvert needs just a few deeper relationships. One of the differences between introverts and extroverts also comes out in communication and energy. Okay, so let's talk about communication. I like to say, extroverts, you always know what they're thinking because they process information externally, right? So what they're thinking comes out in their speech, in a conversation, or in a disagreement. Introverts, on the other hand, process that information internally. They're taking it in and thinking and not necessarily responding. And you might see where this can cause some difficulties in communication. When an extrovert goes about asking questions, giving ideas and sharing, and then says, well, what do you think about that? And the introvert stops taking in information so that they can process it and has to think. And by that point, the extrovert has already answered the question for them, has probably already started on a new path. And the introvert goes, wait, you wanted a response from me. I need to think about that. And sometimes too often, an extrovert may not be able to pause long enough, may not honor and respect that difference in introversion and extroversion, and may just keep on talking. So if you recognize yourself as an extrovert with an introverted partner, slow down, take your time, and their hesitancy to answer you is not disrespect or not listening. Sometimes it's just taking a pause to think and really answer your question. And if you're an introvert with an extroverted partner, understand that they're not trying to be rude when they talk over you or ask you a question, then keep on going. But that's kind of part of their brain and their personality. And one of the things you can do to help them is say, give me a minute to think about that, and actually reinforce that and take that minute and get back with them. So two things: validation and knowing your introvert extrovert differences. One I highly recommend, and this is not an original idea, I can't remember the first name, but a gentleman by the last name of Chapman wrote a book many years ago called The Five Love Languages. Very easy to understand, very easy to read and digest. I think even if you hop on the Five Love Languages website, they have a quick test for you to take. It can be so critical to know your partner's love language and to understand yours as well. When we try to do something loving for our partner, if we go get them a gift and we take time to think about the gift we want to get for them, and it takes us some time maybe to save up for it, and there's a lot of emotional energy that goes to it, and then we give it to them and they look at it and they say, "Huh, thanks," and they set it aside, you might assume that your partner's primary love language is not gift giving or gift receiving, although it might be yours. So the theory of the five love languages is that there are five love languages by which we express love for each other and we receive love. And if those two ideas, those two love languages are a mismatch, and often they are, then sometimes we miscommunicate our love for each other. And so by simply taking that quiz, hopping on the Five Love Languages website, you can learn your love languages, your partner's primary and secondary, and then engage in actual meaningful dialogue about it, but intentional loving exchanges. So lastly, two simple ideas that often seem difficult for some couples. To have a relationship, you have to spend time with the other person. Let me say that again. To have a relationship, any kind of relationship, but especially a connected, intimate partnership relationship with a significant other, you have to spend time together. And I'm sorry if this seems obvious or even a little too basic, but I can tell you, oftentimes, that's one of the primary difficulties in a relationship. When I have an individual call me for couples therapy and say, "Well, we can only meet on the fourth Tuesday of every third month after the new moon because our work schedules, family schedules, activity schedules are so busy. That's all we have. But we don't even need to start therapy because the easiest solution is to spend time together." If you find your relationship struggling, find a way to spend time together, doing things meaningful and enjoyable, maybe even setting time aside. If it's a struggling relationship and all you seem to do is argue, maybe consciously say, "You know what? We're going to spend this hour, this evening, not arguing or talking about difficult things. Let's just enjoy each other's company." And finally, one of the most important ones, if you are struggling with your partner, if your relationship is struggling, talk to them about it. Don't talk to other people about it. Too often when we're frustrated, we go to some other person other than our partner, other than a professional, other than some objective outsider, right? If you're a spiritual person, a priest, minister, pastor, or clergy member can be very helpful. If not, certainly seek a therapist, because when we confide in other people, first of all, when we confide in family members, they are not objective. They're going to have their subjective opinion about you, the other person, and the relationship. And if you go through a process of improving and maybe even doing therapy or some kind of pastoral care, your relationship's going to change, but that person's opinion might not. And that can cause significant difficulty down the road. But that's when you talk to family members, parents, siblings. When you start to confide in somebody else, maybe a peer or somebody at work, often if you do that too much, you start to create a closer, more intimate bond with that other person than with your partner. And in my experience, that can lead to significant difficulties. So if you're struggling, even if you're not struggling, if you just have some frustrations in your relationship, A, talk to your partner about it. You know, that's part of being in a relationship. Relationships have conflict. We take two people from two different backgrounds, we put them together and we say, good luck. And if you don't work on the relationship, if you don't read, study, grow, talk to other people about your relationship, talk to professionals, objective outsiders about your relationship, you simply reenact maybe what you learned in your family of origin. And that's okay for most, but some might need a little bit more. So, hey, as always, thank you for this opportunity to share a little bit of meaning and my professional experience with you. If you would like to learn more or if I can be of further assistance, please feel free to contact me. All of my information is available on danielafranz.com. That's DanielaFranz.com. Thank you again and take care.